In our time frame, so it goes well, I think. I will talk today about the arty way, as I would like to call it, how we do it in the Netherlands. It's said before by Daniel and by Peter. The Romans imported large amounts of stone from the south of Germany, but also from Belgium and France to build at their period. Before that, it was only timber, wood, mud, and nothing much survived. And yeah, we had to come up with an idea to do reconstructions and do visualizations for the public outreach. But having no material to do it with, that's why in 1999, and I will talk about it later, a policy document came out, and architects, landscape architects, and artists themselves were introduced within the work of archaeological heritage management, cultural heritage management, and were introduced to working with archaeologists together in projects and to see if we together come up with an idea to visualize the past. And ART in this lecture stands for artistic and artificial. I'm going to talk about some strategies for the presentation of archaeological heritage over the years. I stumbled across all kinds of examples, small, great, physical, ghost structures, information panels. You've seen a broad spectrum of methods that you can apply. And I try to put them into categories to understand more which strategy belongs to another one and which goals are chased after. I will talk about one example I've worked on, and I have some lessons learned. There are many more, but these are, prominent ones. Like I said, in 1999, there was a policy document introduced, the Belvedere, I have to say. You don't see the accents, but it's from the Italian, Belvedere. And this policy document had a 10-year period with a large sum of money, millions went into this one. So municipalities, but also architects, landscape architects, museum sites could apply for a grant and work out some plans for visualization, reconstruction, or any other form of public outreach. It was a development-oriented approach, typically also for the Netherlands. It's a small country. We live with more than 7 million people. We don't have that much space left, maybe up in the north only. But we have to come up with ideas because it's a multifunctional use of space, not only above soil, but also underneath. And the slogan that was introduced was preservation by development. Before this, everybody said, oh, it's an important site. Put a fence on it, keep your hands off, and we lay it like this. But within a densely populated land as the Netherlands, it wasn't possible to do so. And also, buildings, all structures had to be reused somehow to get a new life and to be kept for the future. So preservation by development was the new credo for everybody to work on. Like I said, over the time, I tried to come up with the strategies, and I divided them into five main categories. Physical protection, making visible, to remember and to refer, and those are very linked with spatial design. And then the bottom two, presentation of the content and branding. And the last one, branding, is more about tourism, city marketing, all kinds of products within the touristic frame, logo development, etc. And presentation of the content is more about the information that bears on the object itself or a complex or whatever, and made clear by information panels. Also digital media nowadays used a lot, apps on your smartphone, etc. But when the architects, landscape architects and artists came, were introduced to our work field of archaeological and cultural heritage management, they also had their own vocabulary. And we used words, and I will go into them and I will show you some examples. We use the term of preservation, and we as archaeologists and cultural managers know what preservation is about, or conservation, or restoration, consolidation. But those guys came up with completely different terms, to cover up, to mark statically, or to mark flexible. But what does that mean? I came across a lot of studies and I tried to disseminate what they meant with that word, and I put them into the scheme so other people also could get a good idea about what was meant by the architect or landscape architect within a project. Physical protection aims on preserving the scientific information in situ and prevent or reduce processes of decay by nature or by man. Making visible, the other main category, stands for reconstructing and visualizing one or more objects, usually of which the original appearance is needed. This often happens with new materials, and design in this case is awarded more creativity. To remember and to refer concerns the design of memorials. This could also be naming of a street or a building. And like I said, all these three top elements and strategies have a clear relationship to spatial design. I won't go into detail in all the pictures, but you see top left a castle mound. It was agricultural landscape. The farmer plowed year after year after year, and all of a sudden it had two steep slopes on the sides. And then a nature reserve company and organization bought the land, made a recreational area of it, and they put it on the profile again, but still having all the archaeological evidence and materials from a wooden face and a stone face buried within the mound itself. Down left, it's a location within a forest of a Roman villa. There was a lot of looting going on with people with metal detectors, and also the forest was standing on the site itself. And as you know, roots from trees will eat all the material that's beneath. So we come up with a plan to cut off all the trees and to put metal mesh on the site and then heighten it up with earth. And now when you go there with a metal detector, you have a constant beep on your head. So it's not funny to go looking for metals again. Like I said, this is also, I made a bracket between physical protection, when the aim is to preserve prominently and making visible, you want to show the shape, the volume, etc. But sometimes there is a combination of those two. That's why I used these two words as well. Now we've seen example. I had last year, I was lucky to go to Beirut, and Lebanese colleagues of mine showed me an apartment complex. Before that, they had some excavations and they dug up a Roman bathhouse. They block lifted it completely, put it aside, and then reintegrated it within the lower basement of the apartment complex, and now it's a unique selling point for everybody who wants to buy a $1 million flat in that part. These are the remains of a brick kiln in the eastern part of the Netherlands. It was laying for years. It's from the 17th, 18th century. It was laying outside for years. There were trees growing up of it, growing up on the walls. And some local, the local neighbor here next door, she asked the municipality, can we do something else? Because year after year after year, I see pieces falling down, it crumbles down, and we have to do something. So we came up with a plan to put a protective shelter or a Schutzbau, like the Germans would say. It's also a very known word. We put up a protective shelter and we did some paneling, and now it's preserved for the next generation. making visible, like I said, you try to visualize volume, form, height, etc. Top right, down right, you see the Roman villa site again. We did also a visualization over there. On the central part, we used a steel construction to give an idea about the width and the height of the central entrance hall, 12 meters width and 12 meters in height. And the outskirts, we used metal gabions, filled building materials that the Romans used to use back then as well, to let people see for now until what extent stretch out this Villa Urbana. Here at the top right, you see a burial mound. It's near a touristic cycling route. One half is reconstructed as it should have been, like that. And the other side is open with one later grave put in. And with coloring of the layers, we try to explain people what a burial mound is and how you have to think about the inner side of one when you see one in the landscape. To remember to refer, it's more, those are more art projects mainly, with lighting or naming of streets or buildings. But this is also a burial mound you see in the back with one piece out of it. It was dug up by the state service in the 70s, but in the late 90s, the municipality of Vaals came up with the idea that they wanted to do something else. So they asked upcoming artists to come up with an idea, and a very young artist, she just graduated art school, came up with the idea. I don't know if you see it in the back, but she put a few pieces of bronze on a stone, and the foundation of this barrow was also from stone, and they found the remains of a child. But you see here her underarm, her upper arm, her head, her knee, her bended leg. So if you see it up front, it's like a little child sleeping on the stone. And if you see it from above, there are only a few pieces of bronze. Very cleverly done. Top right, it's a playground where we use the information from an excavation of a medieval settlement. And we did that in collaboration with new inhabitants. They didn't want to have the playing materials out of a catalog with red, yellow, or blue playing toys and so on. No, they said, no, we have an interesting site here and let's do something with the outcomes of it. Like I said, presentation of the content with all kinds of scale models, information paneling, sometimes small side museums. This is in Rotterdam, in the Markthal. Or also with digital media on the street. Branding, reenactment, it came by already. Also in Groenlo, where we have every 2 years the reenactment. The Spanish are defeated by the Dutch, but also Scottish, English, French were complete mixed armies back then. Local restaurant owner was smart enough to brew his own Frederik Hendrik beer. Now it's selling quite well. But also you have cycling routes, etc., etc. The example I wanted to talk about. Moerenburg is the location. It's in Tilburg. It's a city in the south of the Netherlands, in the province of Noord-Brabant. And east of the city, the north, you have the picture over here, but east of the city and south in this picture, there is a water purification plant. And it's a scheduled monument. The objects in concrete, all these objects are scheduled, also these and buildings over here. But the water organization wanted to re-establish parts of it, and they wanted to extend it and enlarge it, and also want to have a newly reconstructed wetland. And the municipality thought of it as having this location as the new gate for a recreational green area, the hinterland, for all the people living in that side of Tilburg. When they enlarged the wetland, they stumbled across some remains, as later turned out to be Haus Moerenburg. On the spot in Iron Age time, there was already stood a farmhouse. It devolved to a farmhouse in the medieval period, then a rectory in modern times, and later a great estate. A small part of it was excavated, and immediately the local community wanted to make this a scheduled monument. They protected it under their own law, so the rest of it had to be kept underneath the soil, and we had to take that into account for the new development. A landscape architect was asked to come up with ideas, and the first idea they said, it was a U-shaped house, so we put trees on the spot in a U-shaped form. But as I told you, trees on a archaeological monument will kill the stuff on site. So after having a year of working out plans, they didn't come up with the good idea. And then I was asked by the local archaeologist to join the team and have the discussions all over again. What choices do we have to make? What is the new function of this location? There are several dilemmas that we had to discuss. Which path do we take? Because it's a long history on this site. And eventually we thought it would be best, because we have the most information about that period. We take the historical period, the period of the large estate. And doing the research all over again, we stumbled across a painting in the Noord-Brabants Museum in Den Bosch by an unknown painter. It looks very nice, and all the material, this corner was excavated. We thought, okay, now a lot of things match. We don't know for sure if this was really the situation. Maybe the owner wanted to show off and said to the painter, make it more lively and lovable for others to see. But we used it as an idea to come up with an idea for the reconstruction. We had some discussions. At bottom is one point that I want to address. And you see here a very symmetrical plan with an axial axis going through the gate, through the door, and then into the garden. But the situation was something different. And you see it like this. You could see it as a truck. Here, this is the cabin where the driver sits, and this is the rear part of the truck. It was shifted a little bit, how it was found. So we had a discussion, also with the local archaeologist, what should we do? Should we do it like this? But also the wetland you see in the back was already reconstructed, but you don't have a real match when you want to explain to people that back then you had the symmetry within the plants, etc. Or do we do it like this, above the soil? The archaeological remains still remain the same, they will be kept. But we turn a little bit the location, so we can tell the story about the actual development, etc., etc. Finally, we choose for this model after a long discussion, but it helped us to give the information. And now I'm almost concluding. This is how you see it now. We came up with a great idea, a scenic embedding of a architectural structure from cordon steel, and we did some playing with it as well. It's more abstract because when you compare that to the painting, but we put in some architectural details and more detailing in the front door. There was a solar clock we could see on the painting, but we didn't find it. But we put in some small details, architectural details, and what we also did was we heightened the ground plan. So when you now come up and you visit the location, and we did a carving into stone of the painting, it's the doormat now, you walk in and you have already an idea, and then because of the fact that the ground plan, the slope is going up, you don't see immediately what is in the rear. So it stays a bit of a mystery what the garden area is, but that's the fun part to play with, to give people a different feeling. This is a photo from the back within the location of the waterland itself, looking back, and on the edge of the ground plan, we also placed carved tiles with all kinds of findings that were found over there. They came back in photo within a booklet on the whole process, everybody that was participating, all the stakeholders, also local people living over here, and neighbors were interviewed. And together with Calvin Wilson, who will speak later, I did an information panel just outside. We didn't get the assignment for that immediately, but afterwards the local archaeologist wanted to have some more information, not only let the people have and work with their own imagination, but give a bit more information on the site, on the period, on the dating, so people can have a better idea. Some lessons learned, and that's what I've been seeing in the Netherlands, and I heard it from colleagues elsewhere as well. It's not always that we heritage experts come into the process immediately. That's a pity, because a lot of money and time is wasted and we have to do the process all over again. But that's one of the things that I wanted to give as a hint today, and also be very promptly with discussing dilemmas on where do you place emphasis in preservation or development, and which past will you present, and also the discussion on authenticity. And we didn't have much materials here, they're all still surviving underneath. But if there had been, how much creativity would we have put into the plan, or how little? So, thank you. We have the discussion.